Let's look at an example of a pooled variance t-test and confidence interval. In 2001 in Croatia, there was a large increase in the proportion of veterans claiming post-traumatic stress disorder, and this corresponded with a change in government policy to award compensation to those with post-traumatic stress disorder. And studies showed that a high proportion were malingering, meaning they were fabricating or exaggerating symptoms, possibly in order to get this compensation. The Morrell Emotional Numbing Test, which I'm going to refer to here on out as the MENT, was designed as a diagnostic tool to help differentiate between those who truly had post-traumatic stress disorder and those who were malingering. Here are scores on the MENT for 49 veterans seeking compensation and 70 veterans seeking treatment. Higher scores on this MENT are indicative of individuals fabricating or exaggerating symptoms. And we can see here that amongst those seeking compensation, they seem to have higher scores on average on the MENT when compared to those simply seeking treatment. But is that a significant difference? Is it unlikely to observe a difference of this size due to chance alone? We'll investigate that by using hypothesis testing to test if there is a significant difference between the groups. In other words, we'll see if there's strong evidence that the population mean of group 1 differs from that of group 2. And we're also going to estimate the difference in population means with a confidence interval. Here I'm going to call group 1 the group seeking compensation and group 2 the group seeking treatment. But it wouldn't really matter, and we could switch those two around and our conclusions wouldn't change at all. Here again are the box plots with the assumptions of the pooled variance T procedures. First of all, we need independent simple random samples from the populations of interest. And we do have independent samples here. We had a group of 49 individuals seeking compensation, and we had this separate and distinct group of 70 individuals seeking treatment, and they were separate and independent samples. But they were not simple random samples from the populations of interest. They were individuals showing up at a clinic and volunteering for this study. So we'll have to be a little cautious with our conclusions in the end. The pooled variance T procedures also assume that we have equal population variances. Now this is unlikely to be perfectly true, but at a bare minimum we would like the samples to have similar variability. And to a great extent, that's true here. We have this spread for seeking compensation, and we have this spread for seeking treatment, and they're not too far off the mark. One cause for mild concern here is this outlier, and we really should investigate the effect of outliers in greater detail. But it's not too extreme, and it's unlikely to be too much of an issue here. We also require normally distributed populations. The sample sizes are fairly large here at 49 and 70, so the normality assumption is not extremely important. But we would still feel more comfortable if the samples were approximately normally distributed. These box plots are not perfectly symmetric, but they're not showing anything too extreme, like very strong skewness. But let's investigate the normality assumption in a little greater detail by plotting normal quantile-quantile plots. Here are the normal quantile-quantile plots for the two groups. Recall that the points in a normal quantile-quantile plot lie in an approximately straight line if the data is approximately normally distributed. And that outlier in the compensation group appears here again, but again, it's not too dramatic. One could argue that we see a little curvature in these plots, but again, like as we saw in the box plots, it's not too extreme. And with sample sizes of 49 and 70, the T procedure is going to work well as long as the samples are not very strongly skewed or there's other major problems. So I'm going to say that these are reasonable enough, even though they don't look perfectly normal, they're reasonably enough, and with adequate sample sizes here, we can go ahead and use the pooled variance T procedure. Here are the summary statistics for the two groups. The pooled variance T procedure assumes that the populations have the same variance. And we can see here that the sample standard deviations are a little bit different, but they're reasonably close. I think it's reasonable to use the pooled variance T procedure here, but using the unpooled T procedure would also be a very reasonable choice. The first step here is to get the pooled variance, which is a weighted average of the individual sample variances. This is our pooled sample variance, SP squared. and feel free to pause this and take a look at the calculations, but we end up with a value of 17.033. And this is our estimate of the population variance of the two groups. The next step is to calculate our standard error of our estimator, which is the standard error of the difference in sample means. This is equal to the square root of the pooled variance times the square root of 1 over n1 plus 1 over n2. That works out to 0.7687 to four decimal places. And we're going to use this standard error in our inference procedure calculations. Now suppose we want a 95% confidence interval for the difference in population means, mu1 minus mu2. We have all of the information that we need, but we need to find this t value now. And for a 95% confidence interval, the alpha level is 0.05. And the t value that we need is t.025. But we need the appropriate degrees of freedom. And our degrees of freedom for the pooled variance t procedure are n1 plus n2 minus 2, which is 49 plus 70, the sample sizes of the two groups, minus 2. And we had 117 degrees of freedom. And if we go to software or a t-table, we can find that this, to three decimal places, is 1.980. And note that even though we have 117 degrees of freedom, which is quite a few, this 1.980 is still a little bigger than the 1.96 we'd get from the standard normal distribution. So we have all of our values now. Our interval is going to be the difference in our sample means plus and minus the t value of 1.980 times the standard error of 0.7687. And this works out to 3.28 plus and minus the 95% margin of error of 1.522. And if we carry out that addition and subtraction, we get a lower bound of our interval of 1.758 and an upper bound of 4.802. We can be 95% confident that the difference, mu1 minus mu2, lies somewhere in this interval. Note that this interval lies entirely to the right of zero, so that all of our plausible values of mu1 minus mu2 are greater than zero. And recall that group 1 was the group seeking compensation, and group 2 was the group seeking treatment. So this interval gives us some indication that those seeking compensation score higher on the MENT on average than those simply seeking treatment. But let's investigate that more formally with a hypothesis test. Let's test the null hypothesis that the populations have equal mean scores on the MENT. What should we use for an alternative hypothesis here? Well, I would argue that we're interested in a difference in either direction, and so we should be using a two-sided alternative. And here we have our test statistic, and we have all the information that we need to calculate our test statistic. This is simply the difference in the sample means, 9.76 minus 6.48, divided by the standard error, 0.7687. This works out to 4.267. We now need to find the p-value, which we're going to find from the t-distribution with the appropriate degrees of freedom. The degrees of freedom here are the same as for confidence intervals, n1 plus n2 minus 2, which we found to be 117. Here's a t-distribution with 117 degrees of freedom. And we can draw in our observed value of our test statistic here at 4.267. And we can see that that looks pretty far out in that right tail, indicating strong evidence against the null hypothesis. But we should quantify that by getting a p-value. And our alternative hypothesis here is that mu1 is not equal to mu2. And for this two-sided alternative hypothesis, the p-value is double the area in the tail beyond the observed value of our test statistic. Or in other words, here, our p-value is going to be double the area to the right of 4.267 under a t-distribution with 117 degrees of freedom. And if we go to software, we can find that the p-value to five decimal places is 0.00004. And if we had to use a table, we'd see that the p-value is really close to zero. So we have a very small p-value here, indicating very strong evidence against this null hypothesis and in favor of this alternative hypothesis. And so we have strong evidence that these true means differ. And note that the test statistic is far out in the right tail of the distribution, giving evidence that mu1 is in fact greater than mu2. To summarize, there is very strong evidence, based on this very small p-value of 0.00004, of a difference in the population mean scores on the MENT. And a 95% confidence interval for mu1 minus mu2 was found to be 1.8 to 4.8 when rounded to one decimal place. Again, group 1 was the group seeking compensation for post-traumatic stress disorder, and group 2 was the group seeking treatment. And so we can be 95% confident that, on average, those seeking compensation for post-traumatic stress disorder score between 1.8 and 4.8 units higher on the MENT than those simply seeking treatment. The non-technical gist of the situation is that there is very strong evidence that those seeking compensation for post-traumatic stress disorder tend to score higher on the MENT than those who are simply seeking treatment. And recall that higher scores on the MENT are indicative of greater likelihood of malingering. So there is the implication here that those seeking compensation are more likely to be fabricating or exaggerating symptoms of post-traumatic stress disorder. But we really need to exercise some caution in our conclusions here. These were samples taken in Croatia, and as such our conclusions really only apply to those claiming post-traumatic stress disorder there. And also, they were not truly simple random samples from the populations. These were people that were seeking medical treatment at a clinic and agreed to participate in this study. So we never know what biases may have been introduced by this sampling design. In practice, we almost always carry out the calculations using computer software. Our job is to choose the appropriate method of analysis, make sure the assumptions of the procedure are reasonable, and then make appropriate conclusions based on the output. And here's the output from the statistical package R. And we can see here that the t-statistic and the p-value and the confidence interval are the same as what we got, except given to more decimal places.